One of the most reviewed and most reviled rock phenomenon of recent weeks. We got a few votes. Sex Pistols, you can hear them warming up in the background even now.
Sex Pistols play Manchester for the very first time. 42 heads in the crowd, that's it. Among them was Pete Shelley from the Buzzcocks, Mick Hucknall, a group of lads who later became Joy Division, and Tony Wilson, who in time owned Factory Records. Tony was a broadcaster for Granada Reports, and after hearing the Sex Pistols and similar sounding bands, started his own TV show, So It Goes. In this show, he'd play bands from this new wave of music, not knowing the impact it would soon have on not only the nation, but the world. Tony hosted a new wave music night at the Russell Club on a Friday night. People would come and listen to the live music, and for the first time ever, they'd be the judge of who was the real talent. Welcome, Joy Division. 1978. After working with Tony Wilson for a long time, Joy Division agreed to sign a contract with Tony and starting up a record company named Factory Records. Oh, and Tony wrote this contract in his own blood. After this, the new wave music scene absolutely exploded, with indie bands popping up left, right and centre, creating too much business to play only one night a week at the Russell Club. 1980. After Joy Division's quick rise to fame, it wasn't long before their music was recognised by people, not only in the country, but internationally. In all this madness, they were offered a tour of America to play gigs in loads of different states. This excited the band even more, and every member was pumped for it. Everyone except the lead singer, Ian Curtis. Now, there are many speculating reasons, whether it be his drug use, or the strain on his marriage brought by his affair with a Belgian journalist. Or maybe just the fame being too much for him. Whatever his reasons, Ian took his own life just 2 days prior to the band's planned departure to the United States. 2 months after Curtis's death, the remaining members vowed to continue their music by retiring the group's name and forming a new band. Welcome, New Order.
After Joy Division ended, the new band that took their place was New Order, who introduced more synth-type music. Has this influenced you as a music artist?
Yeah. I think Joy Division, New Order as well, influenced me a lot, but not really their genre of music, more that when they came in, they introduced the synth, and that was very different. And as an artist, I like my music to sound a little bit different, so the influence doesn't come from their sound, more their uniqueness.
1982, the Hacienda. After opening this historic club, Factory Records would hire almost anyone and everyone to come and play at the club, which attracted more and more people, with bands such as Inspiral Carpets, The Smiths, and The Stone Roses. This absolutely swept the nation, and the youth drowned themselves in this new and exciting agenda. It wasn't long before the media and the press became aware of this and tried broadcasting a negative impact on it. But the thing is, all it did was drive more and more people to the club and the music, so no one really gave a shit what the media said. In 1988, after playing at the Hacienda for a number of years, the Stone Roses gained quite a following, which encouraged them to release more and more original music. In October 1988, they released Elephant Stone as a single, which made them even more popular. Around the same time, Happy Mondays released their single, Rope for Luck. Both bands started to grow exponentially and became more and more successful as time went on.
When you think of someone that was from the 90s in Manchester and used to love going to all the clubs and the raves, and was into all the indie music, what do you associate with them looking like?
Looking at flares.
Flares, yeah.
Flares, drugs, and sick haircuts. That's all I'm saying.
Baggy. The baggy sound generally includes a combination of funk, psychedelia, guitar rock and house music. Alongside the music, a way of dressing emerged that gave baggy its name. this being baggy jeans, which were usually flared, brightly coloured or tie-dye casual tops, frequently topped up with a fishing or bucket hat in the style sported by the Stone Roses drummer Rennie. The overall look was a bit rave, a bit retro and a bit hippie. 1990, Spike Island. This historical gig could very well be the peak for the Manchester scene. The Stone Roses performed in Widnes to a crowd of 28,000 people and was described as a Woodstock for the E generation. Despite selling 350,000 copies of their debut album in the States, the band cancelled their tour of America, including a press statement saying, "America doesn't deserve us yet."
When the Stone Roses played Spike Island, they played to 28,000 people, which at the time was the biggest outdoor music event in history.
Yeah.
Do you think that a current band nowadays could top that?
No, definitely not. Maybe capacity. You know, newer bands could have maybe even more people, but not the atmosphere that Spike Island had. That was just something else. And I don't think a new age band could recreate that atmosphere that Spike Island had.
No, it's kind of like a double helix. As soon as you've got one band that are heading down on their decline, you've always got another band that are going to take to the stage and begin their incline. So you've always kind of got that double helix motion. So as the sun sets for the Stone Roses for the time being, there's a new band forming in Burnage in Manchester with two brothers as the main faces for the band. Welcome, Oasis. 1994. Oasis released their debut album, Definitely Maybe. It was an immediate commercial and critical success. The album went straight to number one in the UK albums chart and became the fastest selling debut album the UK had ever seen at that time, and went on to be certified 7 times platinum. For those who aren't really clued up about what that means, in a nutshell, that's 2.1 million sales. Even today, over YouTube, Spotify and other streaming platforms, this album has had hundreds of millions of plays, downloads and purchases. So, I guess you could say this album gave the band a huge following and a huge bank account to follow.
What, you asking me if I'm happy? Listen, I've got £87 million in the bank, I've got a Rolls Royce, I've got 3 Stalkers, I'm about to go on the board at Manchester City. I'm part of the greatest band in the world. Am I happy with that? No, I'm not! I want more!
Over the years, the band's frontman, Liam Gallagher, was known for his cocky attitude and fearlessness. He spoke his mind and basically didn't give a shit what people thought about him.
I thought you were a fucking geezer. You're making his fucking jaws up, bud.
Yeah, bring it.
Wanker. You're like a bad dick.
Bring it.
Come on, then. Put your fucking cameras away now, fucking leather, you knobhead.
If you were an up-and-coming artist in Manchester, who would you look up to? Who would be your idol?
Fucking hell, feels sick. Liam Gallagher.
Yeah?
Gallagher Brothers, mainly Liam. Fucking slap, man.
Why is that?
The tunes that he makes, unbelievable. Him by himself, or with his brother. Slap, man.
Yeah, for me, Oasis have always had a massive, massive part of my life. You know, growing up and, you know, Noel and Liam, both of them influenced me and got me straight into the music scene, and I hope that one day when my little lad gets old enough, he's influenced the same way.
Despite his outbursts and rants, the band's fame only grew with time. 1996, Oasis perform at the Nebworth Festival. They played 2 nights to an audience of 125,000 people each night, which were at the time the largest outdoor concerts in UK history. 2.5 million people applied for tickets, which to this day remains the highest demand for a show in British history.
We went on to be not only, you know, really good at what they did, but pioneers in that aspect. They brought along an element of culture and an element of fashion. And really, they really did start to set standards for the industry. Like I said, not just nationwide, but globally.
Yeah. 2009, Oasis split up. After Liam contracted laryngitis, Oasis cancelled the gig at V Festival in Chelmsford. Liam's brother and lead guitarist, Noel, made a statement saying that the gig was cancelled due to Liam having a hangover. Liam then sued his brother and demanded an apology because this obviously wasn't the reason why. Noel then issued an apology and the lawsuit was dropped. Tension between the two brothers rose even more and a fight between them occurred in a backstage arena on 28th of August. This wasn't too much of a surprise to anyone though, because they'd been struggling to perform together since the band originated. The group's manager announced the cancellation of their concert at the Rock On Scene Festival near Paris just 2 minutes before it was about to begin, and a statement that the group doesn't exist anymore. 2 hours later, a statement from Noel appeared on the band's website saying, "It is with some sadness and great relief I quit Oasis tonight. People will write and say what they like, but I simply could not go on working with Liam a day longer." Today, since the rise and fall of Oasis, there have been numerous bands to come forth and try and be the next best thing, with bands such as the Cortinas, Blossoms, the 1975, and even solo music from Oasis' brothers Liam and Noel Gallagher. However, as times change and the sun starts to set on the Madchester movement, the music of the indie scene begins to fade and doesn't have as much of an impact as it used to. The next generation of music that's getting the youth of today hyped up is rap and grime, with Manchester-based artists such as Bugsy Malone and H taking to the mic and giving people a whole new style of music.
How do you feel about the younger generation being more invested in rap and grime music now, as opposed to the post-punk indie scene that's usually associated with
it? See, I don't really mind it personally, because it's like grime is a homegrown genre, and that's good for a lot of reasons. Like, you've got artists like Bugsy Malone in Manchester who, he's grown his own genre and it's become massive now. And I do think the indie scene is dying. Like, there's not enough bands out there that are killing it. There's no artists.
I don't think it's dying. I think it's changing.
It's changing.
Like, now when you go to see band, you don't want to hear like typical rock, like typical indie, like, sorry, Jack, yeah. Like Oasis, for example, because everything is so, like, everything is, it's been done.
I'm into like grime artists from everywhere, isn't it? Like London and like all that. But obviously, being from Manny, and like artists like Bugsy Malone and H, like, it's like, what's called, it's like homegrown, isn't it? Like, makes you proud to be from Manchester, knowing that they're like making like big tunes like that, and they're representing Manny. It's like, yo, they're from my end, you know what I mean? It makes you proud. I've listened to like some of the Oasis and stuff like that. Like, I don't know the names of the songs, and I don't know the lyrics, but if it came on, then I'd be like, oh, yeah, like, do you know what I mean? This is Oasis. I got them signed, the Inspired album, innit? Yeah. Just like, his newest one. It's like, yeah. And then I've got that in it. It's like, I think it's got like 3 albums in it. About 3 CDs. Yeah. I think it was Noel Gallagher that gave Bugsy Malone permission to use, I think, lyrics out of Wonderwall or something like that in one of his songs. So it's like, the grime artist using one of Manchester's most profound bands, well-known bands, innit? Crazy. I'm into grime. Someone else could be into, like, Manchester rock or whatever like that. Even though we're into different music, we're all connected, like, through Manny, like, through Manchester, like,
now, although it isn't a predominantly indie scene anymore, the numbers don't lie in the fact that Manchester has birthed some of the world's greatest and most talented musicians, and the most dedicated and committed fanbase to follow. Thank you for watching.
Manchester's just the greatest city in the world. By far, mate.